morning. Man, glad you guys are here. Please come on in and find a seat. Kind of looks like we've got open space here, more toward the front. We'll see if we can't sing some more folks in. But as always, encourage you to pay attention to maybe some people that are missing around you. Reach out to them. It's always good and encouraging when someone notices if you're not able to be there. I think we still have a lot of sickness going around. We're still battling through that stuff. Did anybody get the cough that seems to last like a month? And then you're afraid to cough in public because everyone's going to think you've got the Rona again? It's been my life for the last 5 weeks. It's finally just about gone, thankfully. So glad that you're here. Pastor Matt is going to come and take care of announcements in just a second. But if I can, allow me to open up with prayer. Over the next couple weeks, you're going to see us change some things a little bit. And the whole idea is to get more focused on worship. But could you please do this for me? As we make effort to focus on worship, could you help by spending a little bit of time in prayer? If you're like us, Sunday morning is very hectic. And if all you can squeeze out is a couple of minutes, would you please, church family, pray about worship before you come? I believe if all of us will start doing that, we will really see God's power. And we have been seeing God do some incredible things. But I want to encourage you, pray before you come. It might change everything, okay? So with that said, I'll open up in prayer, and then Pastor Matt's going to come take care of a couple of announcements. Lord, we are so glad that you have brought us together today. It is a privilege to be called your children. Lord, we desire to love you, but we acknowledge that we have many impulses that would otherwise disappoint you if not for your mercy, your compassion, and your forgiveness. And yet, Lord, we are in this place not only to hold you in the highest regard, but, Father, to ask that you would make us better children. Help us to treat you the way that you, Almighty God, deserve to be treated, with reverence and appreciation, respect and affection. Use the music as a gift to yourself from our hearts. The gifts that are given, may they be given for the right reasons. And ultimately, Father, as we open up our Bibles and study your word, no man could make sense of your wisdom if it were not for the Holy Spirit. And so this day we ask in a mighty way for the Holy Spirit to have free reign in the hearts of those who he indwells and an effect on those who do not know him yet. Whatever you choose to do with this service, we are privileged to be a part of it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Pastor Matt's going to come take care of a couple announcements.
All right. Thank you very much, Pastor. Hopefully you have your bulletins here this morning. If not, I'm sure you can grab one at the end. Or if you just want to simply look at the slideshow on the YouTube channel, you're able to see all the announcements that way. But there are some that aren't always on the slideshow that we'd like to mention as well. But I just have one. I want to mention the midweek service, but also Adam's going to come up after I mention the midweek service, and he has announcements to take care of that I'm really looking forward to. It's going to be really cool, something very unique that we've never done before, and looking forward to that. But I just wanted to mention the midweek programs that we have. On Wednesday, we have the Expeditions program at 7 o'clock here at the building. We just started that recently, and we're looking forward to continuing that. I just started off last Wednesday, and it was a huge success. The kids had a wonderful time. But wanted to mention, this Wednesday is actually the fun night. So all you parents know exactly what I'm talking about, the fun night. Hopefully your kids come dressed up for that time next Wednesday. Also wanted to mention, we have the youth group night on Wednesday as well, meeting downstairs in the kitchen. We look forward to spending time with your teenagers that time as we study God's word and grow in faith together. But also we have prayer meeting at 7:15 through 8:15 up at the farmhouse. So adults, drop your kids off for the Expeditions program and then jet on up to the farmhouse for prayer meeting as you spend time together lifting up the church assembly in prayer. So with that said, Adam's going to make his way on up here. He has an announcement to take care of, but after that, I have a bunch of other ones to take care of as well. So Adam, come on up. It's yours.
Thank you, Pastor Matt. Good morning, everyone. Yes, as Pastor Matt mentioned, you may have seen in the slideshow today, we are going to have a special day for the Expeditions kids this year. Carrie and I have been talking recently about the potential for the kids having their own shirts this year in expeditions, and an idea that we came up with. Well, let's be honest, it's her idea. So it was to do tie-dye shirts for the kids. So on September 23rd, from noon to 3 p.m., we're going to meet up at the farmhouse and ask that you just bring your kids up sometime between that three-hour period. We're going to have hot dogs grilling starting at noon, so come and have some food. And then the kids, we're going to have a lot of the work ready for the kids to do, so it's going to be a pretty quick event for the kids. It's only going to take them about 10 minutes probably to do the shirt itself, because we'll have a lot of the work done already for them. But then they can have hot dogs, run around a little bit. So it's not the type of thing that we're gonna drop kids off and leave them for 3 hours. It's just come, show up, and we'll spend some time and have the activity. And then on October fun night will be our tie-dye night. So we'll get all the shirts done, ready, handed back to the kids before then. So then in October on our fun night, they can wear their new tie-dye shirts to expeditions, and that'll be their uniform, if you will, for the rest of the year. So we appreciate all the parents contributing to that, and we'll be sending out flock notes actually to all the parents and the workers regarding this coming up soon. So the flock note, you may know, be familiar with that through the church channel. We've created a couple different ones for expeditions as well, one for workers and one for parents. So expect to see those coming out soon, and we look forward to seeing y'all there.
Thank you.
All right, thank you, Adam. That'll be a wonderful time, a fun time, I'm sure. Kids will come away colored with all kinds of colors, I imagine, and maybe even some adults, but it'll be a good time. Hopefully you won't miss out on that. Wanted to also mention we have the choir practice at the end of the service today, so people who are participating in the choir, you know who you are. If you have not yet committed, you're on the fence, you're hesitating, you're not sure if you want to, please come join. We would love to have your voice be part of the church choir for our 15th anniversary service, so hopefully you're able to join us for that right after the service. Just come on over by the piano after the service, and we will get the practice started as soon as everybody is assembled. Also, we have going on tonight the final episode of Chosen. Season 2 is tonight. Hopefully you're able to make it for that. As we wrap up Chosen Season 2 tonight at 6 o'clock, hopefully you can come and join us. Also, we have coming up on this Tuesday Paula Fisher's memorial service. If you're able to be a part of that and be a support for Dave and the family, hopefully you're able to be there for that, for the memorial service of his wife Paula. We'll be having that at 11 o'clock. Also, we have coming up Teen Harvest Fest. Some of you teens have already committed. You're like, I'm coming, I'm bringing a friend. If you still haven't said to myself or anybody, or Miss Rebecca, just anybody letting them know that you're coming, please do so. Next week is the deadline for the early bird discount, so it's just $20. If you're hesitating on bringing a friend, if you know, like, I want to bring a friend, but he doesn't have $20, just tell me you're going to bring him. We'll take care of them. But hopefully you can come to that Teen Harvest Fest on September 30th. And then the last announcement I have is for the men's man camp and ladies retreat coming up. You probably saw the slideshow, but October 5th through 7th is the ladies retreat that the ladies are going to. A lot of ladies have already signed up and already committed, but if you haven't, please make sure you have registered and talk to Cherry just so that she knows that you're already going to be a part of it. And also October 20th through the 21st is man camp or men's retreat. Hopefully you're able to be a part of that, gentlemen, as we take a bus or the church van of guys up there and just have a wonderful time together. So with that said, it takes care of the announcements. Our brother Paul's coming with our next song. Thank you.
Let's take our handbooks and turn to number 460, Leaning on the Everlasting Arms. Let's stand as we sing, number 460. Thank you.
want to pause for just a moment this morning to welcome any first-time guests. We're not going to point you out or embarrass you, but we'd love to get to know you better by giving you a connection card. And so if you have never been here to Faith Baptist Church before, as the guys make their way to the back, if you would help us just by holding up your hand high enough for the guys to see it, they'll make sure that you get one of those connection cards. When the offering plate comes by, take that card and drop it in the offering plate. Guys, if you would please make your way to the back, looking for those brand new faces. Look at these good-looking guys, so serious. Make them smile. If you can get them to smile, they have to give you a free pen. Oh, man. All right, guys, thank you so much. And just another reminder, hopefully you think about this. You should. Am I safe? Yes, you are safe in this facility. And those guys are just a part of the things that we do. You're safe and secured both inside this facility as well as outside this facility. I'd encourage you today, if you see Brother Ray Tatro, would you please thank him for what he's doing out there? The skill set that it requires for what he's doing to keep us safe is unique. However, he is open to train others. So if you're interested and willing, but know this, Brother Ray takes being outside very, very seriously. So he watches the service outside, and he's vigilant watching both entrances of our facility. And so genuinely, if you're interested, know that it's not a chance to get away from the preaching, okay? You're stuck with me no matter what because we're on the internet. Brother Ray watches the service, but he also keeps us safe. So if any of you would say, hey, that's something I could do for the Lord, I'm willing to help. Please come talk to me directly, and I'll connect you with Brother Ray. And that's it. We genuinely don't talk about our security all that often because it's online and we don't need people to know how we keep ourselves safe. And so just know we're safe, all right? So thank you, guests. Again, if you got one of those connection cards, drop it in the offering plate. Let's get back to worship. Brother Paul, please come with our next song.
Let's turn our hymn books to 178. The Bible Stands, number 178.
Name. through his shed blood, we pray. Father, thank you for this beautiful day that you blessed us with. Thank you for this place to gather in to worship you today. And Father, we pray now that you bless these tithes and offerings. Bless the gift and the giver. Use them for the furtherance of the gospel throughout the world. We love you. We thank you for loving us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Take our hymn books, turn to 209. Number 209, Grace Greater Than Our Sin. Let's stand as we sing.
Yeah. You know, when world musicians stand up and sing, they bring glory to themselves. But when God's children sing, they bring God's people to their Heavenly Father. Did you see where those two voices led us this morning? Right to the cross. How thankful we are for the work of all of our musicians. If you have your Bibles this morning, please turn to Ephesians chapter 2 to start with. We're going to go to what I consider to be one of the greatest sermons ever preached. But I want to introduce you to just a topic. I think we could spend many weeks looking at the Sermon on the Mount. And sometimes those exercises make us that much more thankful for it. And sometimes those exercises wear us out. And I suppose it depends on both the audience as well as the man delivering it. And I'm not sure that I could ever break the Sermon on the Mount down into a series and come close to what Jesus did with one continuous sermon. And so from occasion, when given opportunity, I like to visit it. Pull just some beautiful components out of that sermon and cause a deeper appreciation for the master of all preaches, Jesus Christ. So I want to introduce you to this concept that we sometimes take for granted, that is often the singular reason that individuals will not accept Christ as Savior. Why is it that religions that preach works-based redemption and reward find within our society the ability to flourish, while we possess the gospel of grace and freedom, liberty, endless affection, not by works of righteousness, which we have done, but according to His mercy, He saves us. We are not in competition. We are bearers of the truth. But those who tell lies are in competition with the salt of the earth and the light of the world. And how do they make it when we stand up and say, God loves you freely, and they say, all you have to do is these seven things, and one of them is give us lots of money? You'd say, oh man, we should be outshining and outgrowing, and yet we don't. Why? It is this singular component. Let me show it to you in Ephesians chapter 2. Last week, we looked at a definition of grace. It is simplistic but deep. Grace is a friendship with God that you do not deserve. And so, for by grace are you saved through faith. Grace, faith. Faith, grace. Lock those two in your mind as we look at the benefits of God's grace being outworked through our faith in our lives. That not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. We often stop at verse 9, but read verse 10. It is the completion of this paragraph, for we are His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. When I was 7 years old, I became the lump of clay on the wheel of the master. And at first, it was rough. I remember when I was in Sunday school, I would get in arguments. I didn't know the Bible at all. I grew up in a home where we had never read the Bible. We did the Lord's Prayer on occasion at bedtime, and that's it. I didn't even know what the Lord's Prayer meant. I didn't know who Jesus was. At one point, before accepting Christ, I thought I was supposed to be Christ. Because no one had told me. I didn't know. I didn't understand the gospel. And yet, out of fear that I didn't know God, I would get in arguments with my fellow students, 7 and 8 years old, not knowing the Bible. I look back and I look over my life. Do you look back at mistakes you've made and kind of sometimes cringe? Those of you that don't do that, oh, I wish I could live like you. My mind can't forget some of my failures, and I look back at those moments when I was at my worst and in front of people, and I just, I want to forget those times. What was I thinking? Just curling up inside myself. It was rough, but the Master's hands were upon me. And gently and slowly, by one turn at a time, he knocked edges off. And my hope is that when he has called me home, like the Apostle Paul says, I have finished my course. I've run. Henceforth, there is laid up for me, I am exactly what God wants me to be, and there's a reward that's waiting for me. I just want to be the vase, the shape of the vessel that he designed to make. And I don't know if it's supposed to have a tiny little opening or a big one. A big middle section or a little one. But I am his workmanship, all initiated by grace and faith, faith and grace. I don't ever want to stop growing, and I hope you don't either. If your thought is you've already arrived, then the invitation is at the front of the message for you. What are you thinking? No one has arrived. And yet the role that faith can play in our lives, how important is it that a believer be faith-filled? For by grace are you saved through faith. That not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. For you are his workmanship created in Christ Jesus. One night a house caught fire and a young boy was forced to flee to the roof. The father stood on the ground below with outstretched arms, calling to his son, "Jump, I'll catch you." He knew the boy had to jump to save his life. But all the boy could see was flame and smoke and blackness. As can be imagined, he was afraid to leave the roof. Have you ever stood on a stage with bright lights in your face? You can't see anything. This boy has this fire blazing in his face and smoke blowing into his face, and he can't see his daddy. As can be imagined, he was afraid to leave the roof. His father kept yelling, "Jump, I'll catch you." But the boy protested on, "Daddy, I can't see you." The father replied, "But I can see you, and that's all that matters." Do you know what faith is? Faith isn't seeing God. It's knowing that he sees you. What if we lived every day of our lives knowing that although I can't see God, he sees me? The implications are massive. And Jesus introduces us to the concepts of faith in dramatic fashion in the Sermon on the Mount. If you would please turn to the greatest sermon ever preached, according to this preacher's opinion, Matthew chapter 5. For the believer, what is the enemy of faith? Insecurity. And what are the ways in which Satan exposes our insecurities? With lies. Faith is anchored in truth, in reality. Although I cannot see it, I know that it is because it's maintained by God's existence. He lives, therefore. Justice matters. Truth reigns. Goodness counts. And kindness changes lives. Faith changes the world. A fish can't live without water. A bird can't live without flying. Men can't live without air. And Christians cannot survive without faith. And I say this over and over and over again, and then we're going to dive into the message, and you're going to think, what does faith have to do with any of this? Remember, our security is in our confidence in a God that we have not yet met. And it doesn't matter if I see him, it matters if he sees me. Let's address some of these insecurities as Jesus does both in Matthew 5, 6, and hopefully 7. Now I say hopefully because it is a large task to capitalize on three major thoughts from this sermon. We may only do two, which means next week we will do the third. It's possible we can get through all three. It depends on how well you listen and how fast I talk. Let's start with the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew chapter 5, verse number 1. And seeing the multitudes, he went up into a mountain. And when he was set, his disciples came unto him, and he opened his mouth, and he taught them. Now, I, as a preacher, study the process of Jesus. He spent copious amounts of time. As we get farther into his ministry, you'll see he is spending time alone with the Father regularly, always. Sometimes to the point of wearing himself out, he spends time alone with God. And so I don't want you to think that he was flippant. He spent 30 years in preparation for this message right here. But know that he did this from his mind and his heart, not handwritten notes. No one could ever do this without the very mind of God. We take for granted because we have it written on our page or on our phone screen or our tablet, but know this, until Jesus says this, these words don't exist. And so drink them from the Master today as he offers them freely. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you and say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven, for so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. Now let's do this in a little bit more rapid succession because it's so much better than you think. I wish I had time to develop the gospel from these verses, the first 12 verses of Matthew chapter 5. He gives you the story of a born-again Christian from start to finish. But let me just contrast what the world considers to be quality. And you think about electing the president of the United States. And I want you to hear these characteristics and tell me that any man would even make it to the first step of primaries with these characteristics. Let's just do the blesseds without the reward. Blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed are they that mourn. Blessed are the meek. Blessed are they which are hungry and thirsting after righteousness. Blessed are the merciful. Blessed are the pure in heart. Blessed are the peacemakers. Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake. Blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you and say all manner of evil falsely against you for my sake. Now, if in your mind you're thinking, I would vote for that kind of candidate, know that the rest of the world never would. Have you ever watched Shark Tank? It's a television program where men who have business ideas come in and they present their ideas to some of the most successful living businessmen in the world right now. That's what they're supposed to be, whether they are or aren't, I don't know. They make it look really good for TV. I'm just not caught up in the business world. But I will say, they say stuff that I didn't know all the time. And it's called what? Shark Tank. When someone comes out with a new idea, they'll say, this is so-and-so from San Diego, California. And he's here to pitch his idea on sponges. And then the guy comes out and the music is like, do-dump, 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 do-dump. And he comes out and they have hot lights. People have talked about this show that's there. And they said they will intentionally wear you out and put hot lights on you, and they'll keep this area warm. And the investors that are evaluating the ideas, they keep fans on them and keep them cool so that the person that's got the idea is sweating bullets. The Shark Tank. Are you tough enough to be rich in the world? Jesus comes along and says, man, the weaker you are, the better of a chance there is. And yet Satan lies constantly, creating insecurities in us. And so here's the first lie that Satan wants us to believe. I am not enough. The world is full of people that think they've got it. I got to spend time with Dr. Schmig yesterday. He took me to a football game in the evening. So I went to the big house, the U of M. Dr. Schmig had tickets and he invited me and we went to this football game. And I've only been there two times. And it was funny because he said, yeah, I get to go a couple of times, but you know, when I get these tickets, a lot of the people that I know try and get the tickets from me. He told me that on the way to the game. He told me that when we got there and we were getting our snacks. And I didn't understand that until we walked all the way down to the seventh row off the southeast corner of the end zone. Seventh row in the big house. We had probably 100,000 fans above us all the way around us. They put on the board, there were 109,000 people in that stadium. And I thought, man, if you could preach to all these people and they actually listened. At some point in the game, the university was up by so many points, they started blowing up these beach balls and throwing them around. And they were bouncing them all over the place. I had it bounce off the back of my head, landed in my lap, and you always found a kid nearby to give it to. And a beach ball landed in a young guy's lap. He was, I don't know, maybe 20? I don't know. As I get older, you guys are looking younger and younger, you know? But I think he was in his early 20s. I'm stretching it. He may have been even younger than that. Maybe he was a teenager. He was tall, taller than me, probably 6'2", 6'3", in the row in front of me to the right. The beach ball landed in his lap after it bounced off his head, and he stood up. No one is really into the game anymore because it's clear that the opponent is no match for the university. And so he stands up with this beach ball and he puts it in his hand and he goes like this. Who wants it? And I thought, man, I preach the gospel for a living and I don't think I could do that right there. And I admired his tenacity, his comfort within his own skin. I'm not that guy. When I'm in that kind of an environment, my arms are crossed, I'm small. I'm like, you know, I'm sorry, I don't want to bump into you. You bump, oh, I'm really sorry. It's just not my kind of environment. This kid stands up, spreads his arms, gets everyone to look at him, and he's like, who wants it? Then he starts pointing. He's got the beach ball. He's got thousands of people looking at him. Thousands. And he's like this, who wants it? And I thought, man, this kid's going places in life. This guy has no insecurity at all. Somebody must have gotten his attention enough because he nodded like this. He took the beach ball. He threw it up like he was on the beaches of California. And he's going to hit it like 20 rows up to that person. Now, up until this point, this guy has been dripping self-confidence. And he's half my age. The only problem is he clearly was not a good volleyball player. Because he didn't hit it up. He hit it straight. And it blasted an elderly lady right in the face only a couple rows from him. And immediately he went like this, he blew kisses, and he goes, I'm sorry, I'm so sorry, I'm sorry. Everyone's watching, I thought, man, this guy, I would be humiliated. But he's still got the show going on, half my age. He turns and he sits down, and I'm still admiring his lack of insecurity. And I'm literally thinking that I wish I had that kind of self-confidence, and I watched his ears go from a normal color to an unbelievable bright red color, the color of Dear Dolores' outfit. And then I heard him justify himself to his friends. Whoops, I didn't mean to do that. And when he turned his face, I could see he blushed like I do. And I realized there is no one that doesn't deal with insecurity. And one of the things that people will often do is compensate because we are that much more afraid that I'm not enough. Jesus Christ comes in with this list. Blessed are the poor in spirit, those that mourn. You spend all your time never grieving. Then you have no awareness of your own sin. Blessed are the meek. Stop yelling and talking. Start listening. You need an answer. Search for it. Be hungry. Blessed are those that hunger and thirst after righteousness. They will be filled. Do you desire to repent? Then know this. The only way that you can be redeemed is through God's mercy. Blessed are the merciful. They shall obtain mercy. And once I have been redeemed, God allows me to live a life pure of heart and a peacemaker. Let me illustrate this thought just a little bit further. I can tell you already it's going to be a two-point sermon. It's not your fault, it's mine. I want you to imagine, like the genie in the bottle, you were granted one single wish, not three, one. And physically, you could put anything in this jar that you wanted, fill it to the brim and take it home and keep it. Out of curiosity, what would you fill this jar with? I think I would put chocolate chips in mine. Money only goes so far, but chocolate chips, they heal the soul. I'm just kidding. What would you put in the jar? Might tell us a little bit about you. Would you put money in it? Brother Mike, would you stuff it with Lion season tickets for you and all your buddies? Believe in now? What would you put in the jar if you were to fill it? I want everyone to think, what would I put in that jar if I were given the chance to fill it? Anything you want. It's no, you're not judging. You want to put money in there? Make sure that you pick a big bill. I wouldn't go with singles if I were you. Probably $100 bills. Gold. That's probably pretty smart. Is there anything more valuable than that? I don't know. Diamonds? Would anybody put anything else? Blessings, you can't. You can put money in here and make blessings out of money if you wanted. What else? You put it in the jar and go home with it. No one else wants chocolate? Beef stew, oh. Or one better, venison stew. Amen. Okay, now you're given a choice today. Which jar would you pick? You can fill it with anything you want. You want this jar or this jar? Brother Mark Scally fills it with coffee of the finest kind, flown from the deepest places. And he fills it to the very top. And then I say, you could have had this one. You know? Which one would you want? Which jar does everyone pick? Which jar does the world pick? But do you know which jar God picks? You, the smaller one. God isn't looking for the big. He's looking for the small. And I will show that to you in God's word if you will please turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 1. I wish we had time to read everything starting in chapter 1, verse 1, but for sake of time, you'll get enough of the context to make sure that we secure the intended meaning of the passage by starting in verse number 22. For the Jews require a sign, and the Greeks seek after wisdom. Still the same struggle. If you can prove God to me, then I'll believe in him. Nope. We preach Christ crucified unto the Jews, a stumbling block, and unto the Greeks, foolishness. They say, impress me with your intelligence, or win me with a miracle. No, how about I tell you that God became flesh, and he died on the cross, and he's not here, so I can't show him to you, because he rose from the dead. Testify God's children with an amen. Because the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. For you see, your calling, brethren, How that not many wise men after the flesh, and not many mighty, and not many noble are called. But God hath chosen foolish things of the world to confound the wise, and God hath chosen weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty. Base things of the world, and things which are despised hath God chosen, yea, and the things which are not, to bring to naught the things that are, that no flesh should glory in his presence. But of him are ye in Christ Jesus, who of God is made unto us wisdom and righteousness and sanctification and redemption, that according as it is written, he that glorieth, let him glory in the Lord. Can I tell you? God didn't give you guys the big jar for a pastor. He gave you a 5'8" son of a factory working UP-born man. I was the first one in my entire family to ever graduate with a 4-year degree, ever. And that is not because I've accomplished something. I come from nothing. It is because nothing is exactly what God is looking for to do something. That is to say, the lie "I am not enough" is nothing but a lie from the evil one. You don't ever have to be enough because God already is. And by faith, accept that he loves you unconditionally. I'm not talented. I'm not strong. I'm not intelligent. Good. You're the one that God wants to use. When Samuel went to anoint God's chosen of Israel, who he would eventually use to be the descendant by which he entered into the world in human flesh. That is, when he established the line of David with David himself, when God made that choice, he didn't pick the biggest son in the family. He picked the smallest. And when David defeated Goliath, he didn't pick the most experienced, seasoned, talented warrior. He picked the teenager, the boy, the ruddy one. It is a lie from Satan that I am not enough. You don't ever have to be. God is. Just look to him. Put your confidence and trust in the fact that he loves you. This is truth. That is to say, the more that you look at yourself, the more insecure you will be. The more you look at God, the less you'll think about yourself, which means the less insecure you will be. It's just simple fact. Lie number one, I am not enough. If I were better, I would be happier. Wrong. If you have God, you'll have all the joy you could ever have. But this means forsaking sin and walking with him, talking to him. Not regarding evil as good, but as righteousness worth emptying your fortunes over. Number two, the second lie, found here in chapter number 6. I don't have enough. I'm not a happy person because I am not enough. I'm not a happy person because I don't have enough. Matthew chapter 6. For sake of time, let's jump to 19. Although if you're willing to read 5, 6, and 7 consecutively with big thoughts in mind, you will be able to see through the Holy Spirit's leading these three lies that Jesus confronts with his sermon. But in verse number 19, we'll look at the second lie, and we'll call this our last. Next week, I'll show you the third. A single point sermon next week. You're not going to want to miss it. Lay not up for yourselves treasures upon earth, where moth and rust doth corrupt, and where thieves break through and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt, and where thieves do not break through nor steal. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. The light of the body is the eye. If therefore thine eye be single, thy whole body shall be full of light. But if thine eye be evil, thy whole body shall be full of darkness. If therefore the light that is in thee be darkness, how great is that darkness? Pastor Matt and I went to a motorcycle riding course this past summer. And it was not only a safety riding course, but it was an opportunity to learn how to handle a motorcycle better than you ever normally would. And one of the tasks I was very nervous about was they put a block on the ground and they expect you to be able to take a motorcycle and turn it tighter than I've ever been able to turn a motorcycle. You're talking about a 500-600-pound instrument that you're going to lean over, do in a tiny circle, and bring back up again. All of the things they were having me do, I could do till I got to that box. And student after student was putting their foot down because we couldn't get the bike to turn around on a steep lean. And the coach kept yelling, "You need to turn your head. Look where you want to go. Look where you want to go. Look where you want to go." And it's so hard to turn your head like this when you're trying not to fall over like this. And so it's just natural you want to go like this. None of us are getting it. We go on lunch break. And the weakest rider in the group he was working with, he was trying to teach her some techniques. She was really struggling. She ended up in the wrong gear, gunned it, hit the curb, and flipped end over end. She was kicked out of the class. Thankfully, she wasn't seriously hurt, but she was very scared. We got back to class. He pulled us all in. He said, "She's gone. She's not coming back. I've asked her to consider coming back to another class, but she's not riding with us. She's not safe, and she's not ready, and I want to make sure you know why." She would not look where she needed to go. She looked where she was afraid of going. And that's exactly where she went. We got back on our bikes. We started doing our exercises. And all of us are like, okay, look where we're supposed to go. And it is so counterintuitive to be going this direction on a motorcycle and look like this. But do you know what happens when you do that? I found myself not just doing the first box, the second box, and using two-thirds of the second box, because you will go wherever you look. If I want to find out what kind of trouble my kid's about to get into, I look at what they're looking at. Jesus says, your body is directed by your eyes. That is, you take in information with what you're looking at, and you're going to head there. Gentlemen, can I pause for just a second outside of materialism to talk about how dangerous our eyes are when we look at things we shouldn't look at? What do you think is the end conclusion of that kind of a thought life? Be careful with your eyes. You will become what you take in. And Jesus says, man, the light of the body is the eye. It lightens the soul. Watch what you're looking at. What do you look at? God's word or stuff? Because the lie Satan wants you to believe is that you're unhappy because you don't have enough. And yet when we look at what the world has, they're miserable and they want more and more and more and they can never get enough. Stories have been told of men who have won the lottery and stood up and said, that was the worst thing that ever happened to me. I was reading an article online of a gentleman who had won the lottery and he kept it a secret. But he called all of his family and all of his friends and he asked to borrow $1,000. I'll pay you back as soon as I can. The entire family, one after another, cousins, distant relatives, friends, everyone he could think of, he wrote down, called them and said, hey, could I borrow $1,000? No, I don't have it to give. And then he won the lottery and announced to his family, I won. And all those people that wouldn't give him $1,000, you say they didn't call him wrong. He said it still ended up being the worst thing that ever happened to him. Because now he knew all these people that wouldn't give him anything are calling and asking for things. Because I just don't have enough. If I had more, I'd be happy. Listen to Jesus. Which of you by taking thought can add one cubit unto his stature? Verse 28, why take ye thought for raiment? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They toil not, neither do they spin. And yet I say unto you that even Solomon in all of his glory was not arrayed like one of these. Wherefore, if God so clothe the grass of the field, which today is and tomorrow is, cast into the oven, shall you not much more clothe you, O ye of little faith? Therefore, take no thought, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or wherewithal shall we be clothed? For all these things do the Gentiles seek. Your heavenly Father knoweth that you have need of all these things. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And all these things shall be added unto you. Take therefore no thought for the morrow. For the morrow shall take thought for the things of itself. Sufficient unto the day is the evil thereof. I am not offering you wealth, I am offering you friendship. And it's a simple question, do you want it? Because Jesus builds the case that you cannot have God and him, or God and stuff at the same time. Him and wealth. Can't have it. Which do you want? And it's a lie if we say, if I just had a little bit more, but know this, minimize materialism by maximizing your trust. That's what Jesus says. You have a problem with materialism? Then start finding ways to trust the Lord for stuff that you need. Faith. Faith is not the ability to see God, but knowing that he sees me. And I can't tell you why, but he sees me for who I am and says, worth dying for. I don't get that either, but I'm really glad he sees it. I don't ever have to be enough. I'm what Jesus was looking for. That makes me happy. In fact, I could have 1,000 people hate me. It was tough when we first started going on YouTube. For the first time in my life, people were allowed to thumbs down my sermons. What does a thumbs down mean? You guys, what does it mean? I have no idea, but they were doing it. And I remember, like, the worst was like 4 or 5 thumbs down. It's like, whoa, who did the thumbs downs? Was it people in our church or not in our church? Was it people in my family? Was it my mother? You know? No, my mom will always give me a thumbs up. She's my mom. Who cares what people think? Do you know what God thinks of you? Do you know what God thinks of you? Worth dying for. 1,000 people can hate you, and it will not affect how much God loves you. 100,000 people can hold you in the lowest esteem, but God says, worth dying for. And not the best version of you, the Apostle Paul says in the book of Romans chapter 6, the worst version. Jesus didn't die for the redeemed version of me. He died for the worst version, the version I hope you all never know about. We live in fear that one day we will have our lives projected on the wall in heaven and everyone will sit back and go, oh. God loves you. You don't have to be enough. That is a lie. Because he is enough. And when I grab hold of that with my whole being, it helps me understand how silly the world is that they think stuff could ever make them happier than what my friend, my Almighty, my God, my Master, my leader, my guide, my King is able to do for me and my family on an everyday basis. What's better, having the money to buy a house no one else can afford, or buying a house with money that no one else thought even possible because it was cheaper than it should have ever been? I've watched people with more money than they know what to do with buy all the things, and the second they get it, it's not good enough. And yet I look at the walls of our home, and I tell the story. You know, if someone says, my house costs $1.8 million, you go, whoa. But when I tell you that we bought our house for as little as we bought it for, saved and unsaved alike go, whoa! Yeah, that's my God. That's what he does for his favorites. And that's what he's done for me. I would rather have the Almighty with an endless checkbook than me with an inflated one. So then stop spending all your time trying to make yourself happy with stuff. You won't. Remember at the beginning of the message, there were sweeping statements that are like, oh yeah, that's okay, well, we'll see. But the Christian cannot live without faith. You cannot survive without it. Why? Because faith gives me access to a friendship with God. And what does all of this mean? I will show you in Ephesians 6 as we wrap up this message. I will even cheat and give you the third. This feels incomplete to have it right here and not at least tell you. So here are the three, and then I will show you what God's plan actually is. It's bigger than anything you were thinking so far. So lie number one is I am not enough. Lie number two is I don't have enough. And lie number three is I am not regarded enough. Next week we'll look at that regarded enough. With a simple thought that has destroyed churches. But let me show you what God's master plan is. It's called the wall of faith. Ephesians chapter 6. Finally, my brethren, verse number 10, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Liar. Put on the armor of God that you can stand against the liar with all of his attacks. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers, against rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all to stand. Stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Verse 16, above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith we shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for the saints. It's an entire sermon to break down all of the pieces of the armor. We won't do it today, but know that the above all means this, that where the plates meet, there is a gap. And so even the best armor is going to have a gap. And the only way to defend against those gaps is to be a faith-focused individual. That is to say, there is nothing more powerful than caring about the way that I am treating God and how happy he is with the way that I'm living the life he's giving me. Am I being the vessel that I'm supposed to be? Is he happy? Is he satisfied? The greatest act of faith in any believer is knowing that one day you will get to hug Jesus and thank him for what he's done. So live like it. Now here's what's cool. I'm going to pick on a couple of guys. Pastor Matt, go ahead and set your stuff down and join me. I'll pick on you first. Brother Adam, Brother Bill Dietz, Brother Jason, Brother Jim Wisman, Brother Pete Brubaker, Tom, Mark, come on, everybody. Chad, let's go. Seth, come on. Don't sit in front, you'll get picked on. Just stand shoulder to shoulder. Yep, just like these guys are doing, that's perfect. Anybody else want to join? Matt, I see your hand. Come on up here, bud. I need a little bit of fill on the end. I want it off the camera this morning. All right. Pastor has, he's lost it. Noah, good job hiding, buddy. Come on up here. I need you. On this side, if you could, all the way across. Soldiers of Christ, stand. Stand therefore. Having our loins girt about with truth, the breastplate of righteousness, the belt of truth, and the helmet of salvation, but above all, taking on the shield of faith. We've got a problem. You guys are too spaced out. I want you to move shoulder to shoulder. It's awkward, I know. Get ready for this. This is God's awesome plan. Because I'm not saved unto an island, I'm saved into a family. Man, that's pretty moving. Someone quick, take a picture of that. I'd like to see that, please. If every man has a shield, what do you have? If every man that is standing in front of you right now is consumed with a relationship with God, with a friendship with God that we don't deserve, what do we have? Individually, we have one guy that's trying to survive, but combined, do you know what we have? It's not a shield of faith. It's a wall of faith. Try and attack that. On my own, sure, can't do it. But if each individual in this assembly stops buying into the lies of the world and focuses on a friendship with God that we don't deserve, I'm not enough. I don't ever need to be. I have Christ, and He loves me. That's enough. What if every man here was consumed with that thought? Satan couldn't touch us. What if every Christian in this church was consumed with knowing Christ, not having stuff? Satan wouldn't be allowed in. The shield of faith is not intended to be a solitary, independent, strong, surviving unit. He is building a like-minded, unstoppable, world-changing wall of force. Because greater is He that is in you than he that is in the world. Gentlemen, please find your seats. Above all, taking on the shield of faith. And that starts with humility. You don't have to be good enough. In fact, if you are, God isn't going to use you. You need to be nothing. That's why when you read Matthew chapter 5, the opening portions of his sermon are all about humility. Because as we focus on ourselves, we sin. If we focus on God, we go from surviving to thriving. And it's a simple question for all that are... I picked on the guys because, ladies, I know you don't do that to ladies. But you're not here to fill a spot. You're here because you're needed. And it's okay to need the person next to you. Your faith strengthens my faith. My faith strengthens another's faith. And together we build a wall that Satan cannot attack. But it starts with simple thoughts. Stop believing lies. And the two that we've covered this morning, I am not enough or I don't have enough. Next week, we will look at I am not respected or regarded enough. Father, as we conclude this service, my hope is that you impress on us as a church family how important it is, not for the sake of self, but for the sake of each other, that we really begin working on our friendship with you. Lord, my concern is that some may be doing the things that they ought to be doing, but never for the right reasons. Lord, I hope and pray and work hard that this assembly is not overcome with the world's carnality. But on the individual level, if we're all honest, we want to be enough and we want to have enough stuff. And so even today, may your Holy Spirit guide us to the roots that are in our lives, the weeds that need to come out. But that you would forever impress in our minds the image of men standing shoulder to shoulder, creating a strong wall of faith. And this is not complicated, it is simple. I may not be able to see you, but I am going to live like you see me. Father, even today, your Holy Spirit may be calling out components in people's lives, things that shouldn't be there, sins, besetting sins, besetting desires. We hope and trust that all of those will be laid aside by your Holy Spirit's leading, that there'll be courage to follow through, to talk to you, and to say that you are all that matters. With heads bowed and eyes closed, just give you a little bit of instruction. We'll stand and give you a chance to respond if you want to. But let me first say this. the beginning of the message, I talked about the major problem in the world is a lack of faith. But often people will not believe in God's existence because they don't want Him to see what they're doing. And if you, as a child of God, have allowed sin in, you are being given an awesome opportunity to get it out. I wouldn't want to die in it. Know this, I have been in that place where I have regarded sin, and I know what that's like. And the only thing keeping you prisoner and captive to those things is your choices. So today, during the invitation, if you have regarded sin that is taking away your desire to see God in everything because you don't want Him to see you in anything, get rid of it today. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness, 1 John 1:9. If you've got sin, get it out. But I would encourage you today, no matter where you're at in your spiritual walk, to commit to being an individual of faith, one who lives like God sees me every day. And I believe that simple thought could knit us so tightly together that when one struggles, we're all there protecting each other, like a wall that Satan himself is afraid of. Let's stand with our heads bowed and eyes closed. I'll pray for the invitation and we'll give you a chance to respond. Father, as we stand to our feet, we take these next moments very seriously. First of all, Lord, I pray that you would apply those things from your word and the truth which you have shared with my heart, that you have desired to be applied to the hearts of listeners today, directly and deeply to their person, and that the things that don't belong would fall off and fall loose, that the work that's done today would be only your work and not ours, conviction, not guilt. I pray for those that have been caught up in sins that they would be set free today. I pray for those who struggle with insecurities, that they would be secured in your affection. For those who've been distracted by stuff, may they be consumed with a friendship with you. Father, keep our hearts tender and open, and may you receive prayer from saints today. In Jesus' name, amen. With heads bowed and eyes closed, as you stand there, the piano begins to play. If you'd like to talk to the Lord, you can sit down where you are. You're welcome to come to the front. But it's a simple commitment. I am going to be a child of faith. I will live every day like God sees me. Would you talk to Him about that? If you have besetting sin, get rid of it now. Father, you have worked among us today, and we are thankful for those who have committed. Father, make us men of faith and women of faith. For those who are already committed, we thank you for their understanding and their relationship with you. And Father, I continue to make one final appeal. If there is a heart that is hard, then as only you can, show them how bad the world is, but how good you are. Now, Father, as we move forward, we ask that you would continue your mighty work in us, with us, and through us. Lord, this ministry doesn't need to be something important, but we are consumed with making you happy. We are humbled that you have chosen us, and we ask that you would keep us centered and authentic for all the days that you tarry your return. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. In just a moment, we're going to let you get out of here, but I want to just kind of describe what's going to be happening for the next couple of weeks so that you know what's going on. We have got the last presentation of The Chosen tonight. I think it's going to be a great one. If you've missed Chosen, come tonight and then see what you should be working on watching. It's been incredible, but watching The Chosen hasn't been nearly as good as the conversations that we have afterward. It's been amazing to see and share what is God doing in your life. So tonight is the last series of The Chosen. If you have missed all of it, I am sorry for you, and I hope that you'll go back and watch it at some point if you've not seen any of it. It's very, very good, or we wouldn't have it here. Trying not to waste anybody's time. So The Chosen wraps up tonight at 6 o'clock. We're going to have the last, I've been saying 6:30 on occasion. I have no idea why. 6 o'clock, we're going to come back for The Chosen tonight. We'll wrap it up. Then we're going to give you time off as we get ready for Faith Builders. I was going to start Faith Builders back up before the anniversary service. Bad idea. So what we're going to do is we'll wrap up The Chosen tonight, and you'll have 2 weeks off. We'll have our anniversary service, and then Faith Builders is going to hit hard and heavy in October. And there's some really great things. I'm excited to show you all in Faith Builders. We also have our Revelation commentary to wrap up. So that kind of gives you a map of what it's going to be like over the next few weeks if you want to be making plans. But then would encourage you, I hope that you are making plans to be here for the 15th anniversary service. We're announcing it. We'll continue to announce it. We're going to be putting out sign-up sheets next week for food and all of those things. And if you have any questions or interest of what's going on, come talk to us. Happy to share with you. Add one more thing. If you're interested in baptism, we'd like to do a baptism service for our anniversary service. And so we already have several people that are going to be baptized. If you want to be, please talk to me. We're going to be having a meeting in a couple weeks to discuss baptism and to get everyone ready. So with all of that said, I think that takes care of our exiting announcements. Have a wonderful day. Try and get some rest if you can. And come on back at 6 o'clock tonight for The Chosen. You are dismissed.